So, what's this about? Well, since the beginning of the OTS, we've had the idea that the research that we do, which is the, for me, I'm slightly biased, as you can imagine, this is the bedrock of the OTS. The unique thing about the NHS is that it has this opportunity to deliver large-scale research using unified systems. So all the things you don't like about the NHS, all the problems, all the lack of funding we have at the moment, shouldn't take away from the fact we have a unique, pretty much unique around the world system. Not only do we have standard procedures within the actual healthcare system, but we've got NIHR clinical research network support. So when I go and talk abroad, and I know other people do as well, the one thing they're amazed about is not that we have funding, not that we have governance in place, not that we have training programs for research, but actually the idea that we've got research nurses whose job it is to recruit people into clinical trials, embedded within all the hospitals across the NHS, is pretty unique. So if we can't deliver these big multi-centre projects, then no one around the world can. And so it's a massive opportunity. Now, I think orthopaedic trauma is well ahead of the game in this, and you've seen some of the results presented and some of the other projects that are ongoing you've heard talk about. What we need to do is decide what we're going to do next. And it's important that the OTS as a group, as a society, determines the way forward rather than just having individual investigators thinking what I think is the most important question. So that's what this next session is about. And we set it up as a dragon's den. So people, four brave knights, two of whom have identified themselves so far, I'm going to have scattered around the room, and Will's at the back as well, are going to face the dragons to present their ideas. Now, last year this got a little bit touchy, which was great for me. I enjoyed that. It was a little bit of heated debate around that. These guys have put themselves on the line to present their stuff to you, so do be at least friendly, at least publicly, to them. However, we're not asking the dragons themselves to be friendly. They can breathe fire all over them and tear their pieces to shreds. So this year's dragons are David Torkson, who's the director of the York Clinical Trials Unit. As most of you will know, York is funded through the BOA to support orthopaedics and trauma trials, and actually David and the team at York have been hugely successful in actually raising the bar with the level of the applications we're putting in, and have had great success now in terms of getting funding in to orthopaedic and trauma research. I'm very grateful for him coming along again today. Our very own president, John Keating, as well. Now, I think John would probably deny being an academic trauma surgeon, but he's done more to push forward clinical trials and research in this area than nearly anyone. And then King of Innovation, and, well, actually a proper research, he does basic science as well. We've got Alan Johnson, the new research lead for the OTS as well. So without further ado, we'll bring up our first brave contender, who's going to be Becky Carney. No one braver. And slightly scary.
Great, so thank you for this opportunity. My name is Rebecca Carney, and I'm going to present ARTISAN, the most important trial you'll hear this morning, acute rehabilitation following traumatic anterior shoulder dislocation. So, shoulder dislocation, I've put up an x-ray in case you've forgotten what they look like. There's a bimodal distribution, and they affect predominantly males under 25 and females over 80. Now, most interestingly, this is a growing population amongst the females over 80. There's currently 24 per 100,000 per year sustain an anterior shoulder dislocation. There are some British Elbow and Shoulder Society guidelines on shoulder dislocations and how we manage them. And they suggest that if you're over the age of 25, you should be conservatively managed. If you're under the age of 25, a surgical opinion is required, and it may be that surgery is the best option for you, but we don't really know. So what is meant by conservative management? So we know that the best guidelines say manage conservatively, but what is this? So there's two documents that you need to know. In 2014, there was a Cochrane review of rehabilitation strategies following a shoulder dislocation. In 2015, there was the best guidelines. Now, the Cochrane review said there's been loads of RCTs. They've all been on whether you should keep your arm like this or whether you should keep your arm like this. And that's frankly bollocks. Who cares? If this position is any better than this position, the patients aren't going to walk around like this. So the Cochrane review said, stop doing RCTs asking about internal and external rotation. And the best guidelines also said, yeah, we don't want any more of this. We're going to just put it in internal rotation, except that it's okay. So the best guidelines say, put it in a sling mobilisation for 1 to 2 weeks. What we do after that is anyone's guess. So the Cochrane review said that we don't have any RCTs. I'm just going to say that again, there are no RCTs on the management of shoulder dislocations. We have no idea whatsoever whether physiotherapy is effective in this condition, yet we routinely refer our patients for physiotherapy. So what is physiotherapy? What are the aims of the treatment? Well, apparently it's to increase stability through restoring range of movement, strengthen joint proprioception. So my question to you is, can conservative management be hands-off advice? Can it be an information leaflet that you give to patients in the fracture clinic setting? Or is conservative management hands-on treatment? Should you go see the physiotherapist, and do you need that one-to-one tailored advice? The Cochrane Review can't tell you, and the best guidelines can't tell you, but I'll tell you at the end of this study. So the plan is all adults presenting with an anterior traumatic shoulder dislocation will be screened. They'll be consented, and we've worked out that we need about 564 patients based on an effect size of about 0.3 with 20% loss to follow-up. They'll then be randomised to either self-management or self-management plus physiotherapy. We would exclude patients who are under the age of 16, who lack capacity, who have instability due to other reasons, such as rotator cuff tears or bony injuries. If you have any neurovascular complication or any other upper limb injury that would affect the primary outcome measure. The primary outcome measures plan to be the OSIS, the Oxford Shoulder Instability Score. So this is a specific primary outcome measure that's been designed for this population, which makes it the right time to do this trial. We plan to do it over 30 centres over 25 months. We plan to recruit one patient per centre per month. The team, so we have an expert team. So I work here at Warwick University, which is the best clinical trials unit. We have Mr. Steve Drew, he's the research lead for the British Elbow and Shoulder Society. There's me, I'm the research lead for the Association of Orthopaedic and Trauma Society. Here I declare my conflicts of interest. I have a dragon, Mr. Dave Torgerson, who's the BOA CTU lead. We have a statistician team, Helen and Nick Parsons, and health economist, Professor James Mason. We plan to submit this to HTA, hopefully for the March round, so I'm hoping that you won't be too damning about it, but I'm happy to take any questions.
Becky, very polished as ever, and yeah, I wouldn't take you on if I were a dragon, but let's see what the guys have got to say. Should we start with Dragon Johnston? Any questions?
I certainly do. This Oxford shoulder stability score, tell me about it. I want to know more about this. This is going to dictate everything, isn't it?
Yeah, so there's something called the Oxford Shoulder Score, and it was found to have a ceiling effect in patients who have shoulder dislocation. So the Oxford team developed something specifically for instability, and this has been validated in patients predominantly from ages 20 to 40. Now, I must admit, I've not found any validation papers in that older age group, which is something I'm quite specifically interested in, but in the absence of any other patient-reported outcome measures for shoulder instability, we've gone with that. There's been a few systematic reviews, because obviously there are a few other shoulder scores, and the OSIS has been shown to have the ability to differentiate between treatments and not have this floor and ceiling effects that we see in other shoulder scores.
Is it just a questionnaire or is it an assessment? You've said, basically said you want stability, proprioception, range of motion, all these things you've come up with.
Yeah, so all those things form part of the intervention, but the actual outcome of the intervention is patient reported in terms of their functional scores, feeling of instability is what these questions it asks about, as well as daily function. And we'll also be looking at EQ5D5L, which is a more blunt tool, looking at resource use across the NHS and society, so things like return to work and so forth. So although the intervention is about range of movement and strengthening, we're not planning to measure range of movement and strengthening, because who gives a damn whether you've got this much difference or this much difference between strength measurement? What I want to know is, can I brush my hair, can I use my hair straighteners? And that's what Matt wants to know as well, after he's dislocated his shoulder. So, you know.
Okay, right. So, Dragon Torgerson, I think.
Yeah,
I. What about the outcome measures?
Okay, I think we need trials in this area, so I think because there's a lot of stuff that we don't know. One question I had, I mean, you mentioned that you're going to treat one group with physiotherapy. Mm-hmm. Well, what do you mean by that exactly? So, is it going to be standardised in some way?
Yeah, so what we're currently doing is a national survey of all the trauma centres with the physiotherapy lead to ask them what their current practice is. And we're also doing some qualitative interviews then with some of the key stakeholders. And if the programme got funded, and we would then do a workshop where we got a consensus exercise of what is physiotherapy, because you're quite right, there's physiotherapy and there's physiotherapy. And we do that for the advice sheet as well. So again, there is a standard set of exercises which are outlined in the Cochrane reviews, being accepted as this is what physiotherapy should look like. And we will include things like range of movement, strengthening joint proprioception. They'll be the overall headings. Then within that, there'll be a menu of specific exercises that you can do. For the advice group, they will be quite prescriptive in terms of do these exercises. For the one-to-one physiotherapist, they will have an extended menu. So they'll say, okay, these are the things, this is the basics, this is what we'll start with. But then you can tailor your intervention. But these interventions will still hone in on increasing range of movement, strength, or proprioception.
Yeah. So one concern that I would have is just, yeah, trying to get it standardized as to what physiotherapy actually is. And then, of course, as you're probably aware, there is a bit of a postcode lottery in terms of access to physiotherapy services across the country, and in some places it may be more readily available than others. So actually getting the interventions timed and standardized, I think, is going to be a problem. Now, the second comment I would have about the study is that if you recruit everybody into the study, we're talking about people with actually completely different sort of problems, because if you take males under the age of 27, then your recurrence rate is greater than 50%. In the elderly age group, as I'm sure you're aware, you're going to have the main issue there is rotator cuff tears, sometimes with neurological injury. So they actually have a very different prognosis. And a lot of those patients, of course, in the older age group will have either a pre-existing cuff tear or will have extended a cuff tear. So how are you going to account for that in the design of the study?
Yeah, so we're going to exclude anyone who has any evidence of an acute rotator cuff tear. So anybody who feel it's pre-existing rotator cuff, something that was there already, we're not interested in. But if it's an acute injury, then we'd exclude those. We'd also exclude any patients with neurological injury. I put this slide back up because you'll see the in brackets, we put query under 25s. We've been having a massive debate within our own group about whether or not there's any interaction effect with age and whether the 25-year-olds might respond differently to advice versus physiotherapy versus the 80-year-old. But according to the best guidelines, if you're over 25, you get treated exactly the same regardless. So using the national guidelines, we were going to propose using 25 as that cut-off. But actually, if you're under 25, the only difference is that you have a conversation about surgery. So then we saw absolutely no reason why, if at the end of your conversation you decide to have conservative management, you didn't take part in the study. So all conservatively managed shoulder dislocations. And then we do pre-planned subgroup analysis for the under 25s and over 25s. I'd say there was a discussion about whether we could power the study to look at interaction effects, but the sample sizes were just coming out too big to make it feasible.
And finally, in terms of follow-up, just remind me again what the duration is, is 12 months.
Yeah, so the best guidelines stipulate that any research done in shoulder dislocation should have a minimum of 12-month follow-up. And this is so that you can collect the complications on re-dislocation rate. But actually for a rehabilitation study, the point at which we think we will find the biggest difference is at 6 months. And actually 6 months is quite an important time point, because again in the best guidelines, at 6 months, if your conservative management has not worked, that's the time point at which you're advised to have a follow-up appointment with your consultant to then discuss adaptive management. So the treatment pathways alter after that six-month time point.
But with these kind of follow-ups, you probably aren't going to pick up people with recurrent dislocation, because, I mean, you'll pick up some for sure.
Yeah.
But obviously a lot of people who get recurrent dislocation we'll get it out with that time frame. And actually, for a lot of the younger patients, I think that is probably one of the key outcomes, right? Because most people are going to regain their shoulder function in due course and will be okay, but then we'll go on to...
Definitely. So I say we've taken guidance from the best guidelines, which says 12 months. In terms of acquiring funding, if you ask for funding for longer term follow-up just to collect complication rates, they get a little bit, you're not going to do it. And so generally what we do is ask for funding for 12 months in the first instance, and then go into longer term follow-up with some other bits of work.
Good, well, it sounds an excellent defence for the project there. Some pretty nasty questions, but you've handled that very well. So out to the audience, Richard?
Do you not think you'd be better off sticking to a population of, say, between 16 and 40? Because they're the ones with the highest incidence of redislocation. The elderly are a huge challenge in as far as you don't know the time of dislocation, not infrequently, or the frequency of it.
Yeah, Yeah, and we've had a huge debate about that. Actually, we've looked into the literature, and there's no evidence to suggest that in terms of the functional outcomes in the OSIS, and that there's any differences between those age categories. So that's why we're also unconvinced about any interaction effects with age. But you're quite right, in terms of complications and redislocation, there is a big difference, but that's not a primary outcome measure, it's not what I'm interested in.
Great, okay, I'm going to miss David off from the Dragons because he's obviously involved in this one, sir.
Just quickly, are you going to, well, two things. Number one, you're saying anyone who's managed non-operatively,
yeah.
Who's going to decide which patients fall into the non-operative
group?
So
that will follow normal clinical practice. So anyone over 25 who's a simple anterior shoulder dislocation with no complications will be non-operative. Anyone under 25, discussion with your consultant.
I presume you'll have to exclude those over 25 who will still come into a FRASH clinic or somewhere, and someone will have that discussion with surgery with them, because it's all going to be patient dependent, or you're going to say everyone who comes through the doors will have to fall into this protocol?
According to national guidelines set by the British Elbow and Shoulder Society, anyone over 25 should be having conservative management.
Sure, okay. All right.
What you're saying is anyone who's not following the national guidelines, what are you going to do?
And the other question is, are you going to MR or MR arthrogram everyone to see how it's going to be?
No, so it's a clinical assessment for suspicion of rotator cuff injury. And obviously those patients will be sent off for ultrasound scan, but they'd be excluded from taking part in the study.
Good, it's fantastic. Sorry, I know Simon and Sam had questions as well. We've got to move on to the next one. So, right, on behalf of your shoulder surgery colleagues, we tried this before, who would be happy to randomise patients into this trial? Who would be happy personally to randomise? Can you put your hand down? Yeah, you're all still happy to randomise? Fantastic. Thank you very much, everyone. Right, Will's up next to face the Dragons. An entirely different topic. So, what is this process about? Now, the Dragons aren't sat there with a big pile of money. But they are sat there with something much more important, which they can hand out with your support, and that is access to the clinical trials unit and the expertise and the collaboration that this society offers. So that's what's on the table here. Right, Will, over to you.
Good morning, Will Oldley. I come from the northern powerhouse of academic input to orthopaedics, which is Middlesbrough. And we're often understated, but rarely wrong. So, Becky, I'm really grateful. You said your thing was the most important question. It isn't. This is. The reason why this is more important is because this was given an entire session yesterday at our own meeting. So I think that validates what we're about to do. So, what's it about? You've seen this before. It's about this versus that. Okay, so we spent a lot of time yesterday talking about this. It raised a lot of issues, there's a lot of discussion about this, but this is where it's at. This is a question that we have to answer, and we're remiss if we do not. So how do we do it? So it's about hind foot nailing versus fixation in older people with ankle fractures or ankle injuries involving the distal tibia. But you know what, I came here and I was a bit worried about this, because I knew that you'd all say, we know all this, Will, we've been here before, we know all this. Well, there's this study, this is a great study, which has told us about how to treat ankle injuries in the older adult. We've seen this one, Peps and Mr. Winston's around. This is new, this is back in 2000, there was a problem. Again, there has been some relatively good systematic review, meta-analysis on this subject. We know all this, don't we? Well, I put it to you, we actually don't. We really do not. And I feel quite passionate about that. Most recently, this is in press. So this is a small randomized controlled trial about hindfoot nailing versus fixation in ankle fractures in the elderly. So, I could stand here accused of trying to reinvent the wheel, but I think yesterday, if we cast our minds back to yesterday, there was enough questions asked yesterday to fuel more interest from us. So you might say to me, well, you know, go back to the north, in the snow, we know all this. But do we really know this? I'll put it to you that there's a slightly out of focus copy and pasted element there of the close contact casting trial, but Open fractures were excluded. Diabetics, significant comorbidity, dementia. Okay, now I put it to you, most of you work in places similar to me, that a lot of the people that we don't know what to do with are these people. Okay? And the more recent trial, that this is in, as it's in press, available online. Look at this, the same thing. Open fractures, diabetes, dementia, high energy. So we know how to do a surgery really, really well. There was a lot of debate yesterday about what we should and shouldn't be doing. The evidence excludes the one group that I feel I need to know most about. I do trauma surgery, I do frame surgery. I can't put frame on, I could, but I know I shouldn't put frames on some of these people. I really don't really want to operate on them in terms of internal fixation. Should I be hand foot nailing? Should I be doing a fibular nail? I love the fibular nail. I wrote a letter to Tim by the BJJ, which he's not very happy about, I imagine, about it. But it's a great implant, but not for some of these where you've got distal tibial failure at that level, I don't think. So I put it to you that we don't know how to treat all of these patients. So what I would like to do with your support, I feel we need to look at people that don't do their own shopping. We need to look at people who can't mobilise independently. Because you put it to me, I don't want to trash that person's subtalar joint. Well, I'm not going to do that. Put all those dirty nails up through the subtalar joint. I'm not doing that. Because my patient's 75, they're in Guildford, they play tennis. They don't do that in Middlesbrough, but they might do in Guildford. Right? But we're not going to do that. We're not going to include those people. Because the group is big enough. So if you don't do your own shopping, you can't mobilise independently. You're over 65, you have a fracture involving the tibial metaphysis. So these are a shear type medial malleolar fracture extending into the tibial metaphysis. Open or closed, intra-articular or extra-articular, because that gets around a lot of the exclusions of things like fixed DT and other trials struggle with. Cognitively impaired or non-cognitively impaired. Now, this is where the big issue is. None of the trials report on this very well. But these are the groups that are going to get up and walk. If you look at any of the studies where they've had problems, they have excluded these people. They've excluded people who cannot control their early weight bearing. We need to answer this question. I put it to you again that we're remiss if we don't. We know how to do the easy group really, really well. We don't know how to do this. The outcome. Now, I do not want to do a clinical score. If you look at most of the trials, and Tim will say this from his fibular nail trial, and there's been other trials, trying to get clinical significance in this group is really very hard. You're looking at 700, 800 patients to get clinical significance. What I want to look at is I want to look at people who've gone back to theatre within a year of their injury. Because these people we operate on once. If you're operating again, it's because something's gone wrong. That's a hard endpoint. That's what it's going to be powered to. Looking at recent trials, we can go into the detail later, but you're looking at a 15% difference between hind foot nailing and fixation in terms of return to theatre, 15 to 20. So to drop that even by 10% is doable. That's the hard powered endpoint. Secondary endpoint, then you can look at complications, level of function. Length of stay is a massive issue. These people, when they get nailed, they stay in hospital less. Health economics-wise, it's really important. We'd be remiss not to look at this. And then from there, you can go cost. I think this is really important. I think we need to look at this properly. I think that we've been skirting around the edges of the groups that we can study. Matt's work on consenting the group. This is the hip fracture group. They just have an injury down the bottom. We need to look at them the same. Thank you.
So David Dragon Torgerson is involved in this one as well, so should have the most cutting comment of all.
You didn't correct the previous speaker's thing about which is the best trials yet, because of course it didn't want it. Your outcome, I think that I can see why you're doing it, partly because of with the paper insurance with dementia is going to be difficult, if not impossible, to get a quality of life outcome. And I think probably unplanned surgery seems best. I mean, I wouldn't worry about the length of stay as an outcome, because I know a lot of surgeons often see that as a nice outcome to have, but the problem with that is you can get an ease that you can get a really good reduction in length of stay if you kill the patient off during the theatre, because they have no length of stay. And so if you have a mortality problem, and that may sort of affect your return to unplanned surgery, because if you again bumping them off during surgery, they're not going to come back again, are they?
Yeah, and the mortality rate is about 30% in 1 year for this group. So it is considerable. So that is a factor. But the studies, I don't know if other people in the audience might want to comment, but ultimately, but they have shown that is one of the big differentials that they've shown. Because you can mark it on Parker autonomy scoring and all the rest of it. It just seems to be that that group get back to function / out of hospital faster. So I think it wouldn't be something that I'd power it to, but it'd be something that I think is really valuable in answering these big questions nowadays about what's going to do with people.
So some concern about outcome measures for modern dragons. Any of you guys? John, do you want to have a comment?
Sure. So I think the problems with this trial, Will, are one is you're going to have a lot of difficulty recruiting to it, I think. And the reason for that is I think most surgeons, despite what we heard yesterday, will probably consider a hind foot nail. They will view that as a sort of a salvage type of procedure. And most of these patients, and you know, I'm speaking just purely the way I would react to this if I was asked about it, in our unit, we treat these patients, number one, if they require surgery, with fairly standard operative methods, and actually, you know, the complication rate is high, but we don't find ourselves reoperating on most of them. So I think actually, with conventional methods, in the majority of patients, they'll actually do okay. The other thing is the inclusion criteria are very diffuse in terms of that of the fracture patterns that you're dealing with. So you've actually got a very heterogeneous spread of injuries in that, and that's going to be a problem, I think, because some of these injuries are really bad in terms of their associated soft tissue problem, and then they're lumped in with a lot of, you know, low energy osteoporotic fractures that actually are relatively benign, and I think that's a concern. But the actual number of patients, this group that you're talking about, we see them, but it's not a massively large number of patients, and so I think to recruit a really large number and show a difference that you can relate to specific fracture patterns and come out with a clear-cut recommendation, I think this trial, the way it's designed, is going to struggle to do that.
Will, do you want to come back on that, and then we'll, you got a question on?
I take your point. I think that we don't know how to manage the people that have the injuries around the distal tibia well in this group. And I think the problem is if we make it too prescriptive about what you include, you'd never get the numbers. We've all got these people whose skin and bone have failed at the bottom. And I personally feel the numbers are big enough to do it. And I think that if we were too prescriptive, we would never get there. I think that the fact that it involves the distal tibial metastasis is absolutely key. Because actually, those ankle fractures, the low bone, purely malleolar fractures, wouldn't be included. So I think that you're to snap your distal tibia, they are different. They're the group that should get fitter than male, the ankle fractures. So that's why I think that there is less heterogeneity than I think I perhaps portrayed, I think.
So malleolar fractures, the low-energy malleolar fractures would be excluded?
Excluded. Because I think that we know from the evidence how to deal with those.
So you just talk about peel on and
distal. These are distal fractures involved in the distal tibial metaphysis. Now how we quantify that in terms of another squares and kind of thing is up for debate. But these, they're the group, if you put the fibula nail in, that's where the locking screws come in. I think that's why. So there's probably less, I've probably not portrayed it as clearly as I could, because I don't think that we actually know quite how to quantify that. But if it involves the distal tibial metaphyseal bone, they're a different group, which I think will narrow down the heterogeneity which you want.
Good, right, we've got to keep ticking on our calendar.
Yeah, I think you've got to be congratulated for not using an outcome score at all. Well, when you know it, I think that's fabulous. No mention of EQ5D. It's brilliant. I love it. I like some objectivity, and I'm pleased to see that there are problems with this. You're going to have difficulties recruiting something to this. I think perhaps you want to look at percutaneous fixations versus open fixations. And I think that's what you're trying to really say is your complication rate.
Sure, absolutely.
And even though you've probably written something, you said you've written something damning about fibular nails, you can also do fibular screws, bashing these up people's ankles, and they don't come back either, because all we're trying to do is put the foot crudely underneath the tibia. And I don't know whether that would be a consideration as you actually look at that as being a modification of the study you've come up with. Because whether you use your three point small frag screws or large frag screws, they do work. As a consideration I would put to you.
Absolutely. This is opening up and fixing versus sliding screwing and
Okay, a couple of questions. Just time for a couple of questions from the audience. Starting first.
I think it's a brilliant study. We really need to know the answer to this. But as we discussed yesterday, are you excluding non-operative treatment?
Yeah. The reason being, something I think it's a really valid point. I think it just needs to be open. I've been really enthused by the fact some of the Sammy's been saying, and there's some things that we just don't know, right? But what I do know is if I've got Mrs. Megan's who comes in and she's 72, she's a bit demented, with a left ankle fracture, it's going to be very hard to randomise her into non-operative. You're not missing on the equipoise fence with her. So I think that's why the problem is with this.
You would be having some patients with really bad displaced fractures.
Yeah.
And some with not badly displaced. So there will be some patients you would think, considering everything, I'd rather treat as non-operative.
And this is what goes into the heterogeneity thing. There is an element, but they are a heterogeneous population. That's the issue.
So some issues about defining the population? I've got feasibility coming into mind. My head's gone. What do you think, Nigel?
I think it's a great study. I have an issue with Alan's comment. I don't think you can randomise to percutaneous versus something else, because I might argue to you that my plating is percutaneous. So it's two completely different techniques, and there'll be such grey areas of definition of what is percutaneous. As Peter Warlock always used to say to me, anything that's bigger than staphylococcus is not percutaneous.
Fantastic, Brent. Thank you very much. Well, good job. Excellent. So next... the next person up to face the dragons is Alex. He's next on the stage. I've got one other announcement to make, something we did at the Trauma Trials Day, but which you might not be aware of before. Hands up in this room, who's principal investigator on a trauma trial? So that is just brilliant. So we had this discussion at NHR level recently. Who were the most important people in there? The patients were, fair enough. The research nurses second, which is probably true as well, and it was the local principal investigators who actually delivered and, you know, involved their colleagues and engaged their colleagues who were considered most important. The research nurses put forward their suggestion for who their best principal investigator was in the whole trials network, and then that was judged independently by National Institute for Health Research and Clinical Research Network. And I'm pleased to announce that the winner of that prize for this year as the best principal investigator of the year was Andy McAndrew from Reading. So just a quick round of applause for them. Probably the most valuable prize going, although not monetary or indeed alcohol yet. Yeah, it will happen. So, all right, over to Alex for the next presentation.
Right, thank you. So I am not pitching a randomised controlled trial. I am asking for help in assistance in validating a new way to classify open fractures. Here's the rub. Are we confident, are we happy that the way we currently describe and classify our open fractures is of value, is accurate, and represents what we do in the modern world? So this paper is the original description of open fractures and was based on a combined retrospective and prospective analysis with, some would say, questionable scientific methodology behind it. The descriptions in that paper were rather subjective as to what the different grades of open fractures would be, and it was followed up by another paper that showed a bit of evolution in that description, and then actually a review article some years later where this terminology used to describe the grades of fracture had changed yet again. So there was a change from the original description to the later descriptions in the language used to describe open fractures. Other groups have tried to reclassify open fractures, and those are absolutely fantastic if you want vast quantities of cumbersome data or cumbersome descriptors in how you talk about open fractures. But there are limitations. If we look at the original Castillo-Anderson classification, most of the descriptors are extremely subjective. One man's extensive stripping is another man's, oh, I've seen worse. you know, massive contamination. What's massive contamination in one unit compared to another? If you have lots of different descriptors for each grade, you offer the ability to stray, and there's a challenge in trying to put one fracture into one group versus another when you have so many options in the way you describe things per group. And you invite bias, or I've seen worse. We'll call that a lower grade than the one I saw last week. The only outcome in the old scores is relating to infection. Energy level. I put it to you that the energy required to deliver the human tibia or femur out of their soft tissue envelope means they are high energy fractures in the main. And size. Does size matter? Is 1 centimetre in an upper limb wound compared to a lower limb wound the same? Is 1 centimetre in a child's fracture a different proportion of the limb to an adult fracture? Is size relevant? And then people did silence for us on the original classification, and we know in the published literature that actually the inter-observer reliability of the original study is not that good. And the whole thing ends up with a loss in translation. If we can't all speak the same language, who knows what's going to happen? And that means if we decide how we look after things based on that language, so what our standards for practice are, or where we treat the patients, or how we report on treating those patients. If that's all based on a language that we're not all speaking in the same way, in a different dialect, then we have to challenge that. We have to ask, is that right? So we need a real-world classification system. We need to remove the subjectivity from it. We need to have as few identifiers for each grade as possible. And predominantly base this on a binary system, I'll explain in a second. And we need to look more than anything at things like the function of the patient, the effect on the patient of having that, and the resource consumption in the modern NHS, not just infection. So for my money, the descriptors we use are based primarily on the soft tissue alone. And soft tissues can be good or bad. It's really quite simple. And by that I mean, an open fracture, therefore, can be simple or complex. Simple open fracture. Any open fracture where the soft tissue envelope can be closed primarily on the assumption it has no features of complex fracture. A complex open fracture is any other open fracture. So we still have to subdivide these because we're not trying to reinvent the wheel. I don't want to change. We're not going to be able to completely move away and produce something new compared to the Castillo-Anderson. What we need to do is take what we all know in the orthopedic community, but make it real world and modern and up to speed. So a complex A, the skin was closed, but something else happened. Fell over into some farmyard, or maybe you manipulated the bone to achieve soft tissue closure. Because the function and the burden on that patient now with a shortened limb has to be different to someone who had a normal length and the wound was closed up. Or bone loss and a closed soft tissue envelope. A complex B, the plastics did something. And this is where there's a lot of loss in the original translation of what got involved, what level of plastic surgery. And there's another group of patients that have never been included in this whole process, and that's the group at the bottom, the compartment syndrome limb. The functional outcome and the resource burden from a compartment syndrome limb is no different to a 3B tibia. And so we need to include those in this group and make it real world. And it seems something happens with the limb vasculature. So that is the 3C classic repair, but also the traumatic amputation or the amputation for an unsalvageable limb, and the single vessel leg, which has a higher rate of wound complications and non-wounds. So those are basically the broadest categories that we can have. But if you notice, they're very clear that there's only a single identifier for each grade within that, and we've removed the whole lesser end of the spectrum down to one distillate, the primary closure of the wound. So I'm pitching because I want some help in validating this and realizing this. And I've done some work already on this and had, if you like, a focus group at an orthopaedic meeting in another country, and the results initially were very encouraging, but it's very user-friendly. But we have to represent modern standards. We have to challenge dogma. We have to avoid all those original issues and look at what we do in the country at the moment and how we describe what we do and ask, is the language we use at the moment right? So I'm asking for help in validating this score and evolving this score if we feel that there's a real error or we're missing something as well. So thank you.
Something totally different. Who'd have thought it's a novel idea for the clinical community to consider? So we're going to start with the audience this time, and then we'll move on to the dragon. So this is an issue of clinician need, isn't it? Do we need a new open fracture classification? Any views from the audience? Is everyone happy with what we've got?
Sounds good. How are you going to do it? How are you going to validate it? What's your plan for doing that?
So I think we've done it's a three-stage thing. So the first thing I did was I presented this in the Spanish Orthopaedic Association. What we did was we did a series of cases on a screen with an audience response system, and I got them to classify according to the original. Then I presented my pitch in a much longer talk. And went through the details and then got them to reclassify all those cases with the new system. And so I have some crude data to prove that in a short period of time, a bit like a focus group, it is sort of sensible enough that the language is okay, the way we use it. The next step will be to ideally find a good resource or pool of data that exists already that we can sort of retrospectively validate to work out how we're going to go ahead and prospectively validate, and in an ideal world, with TARM, the ability to prospectively collect data on a huge number of fractures in a relatively short time might be the best solution.
Good, good. Other questions from the audience? Are you all happy? Does everyone feel absolutely we don't need a new classification system?
When we sat down with the NICE guidelines and talked about this, one of the things that struck us was the only thing that you can readily say is whether it's open or closed. So that's fairly clear. So the driver in the initial management is where it is. So is it a big bone? So exclude your fingers and your wrist and your toes. But then it should go to an orthoplastic unit. So to try and take out the problems of that assessment being made and determining treatment from an early stage by getting it wrong. And then it's open to the eyes of the orthoplastic team when they see them to then work out their strategy. So if I was thinking what the value of it's going to be, it's not going to be in that initial triage of the patient, because I think that's been simplified for our environment anyway, is that they're either open or closed, it's a big bone or it's not. But it'll be how you can make it useful for the orthoplastic decision making and the running of the units. And I'm not quite sure how that works.
So I don't think you have to be careful as to what you want to do. Do you want a classification for decision making in terms of how to definitively manage stuff? And we thought about this and had a long chat about plastics, because, you know, is a little local gastroplasty the same as a big free fracture? The problem is you have institutional and individual variation in what people want to do to fractures, skeletally and soft tissue wise. So you have to be very careful about using this as a decision-making algorithm. But what we need to do is have a better language we use to describe what we're doing in general to these populations. And the problem at the moment is that I don't think the language we use is tight enough, and I don't think it reflects modern medicine in terms of resource consumption, the network performance, and those sort of things. So I think you have to be careful of choosing what the tool is for. And we're all big enough and old enough to do our own decision making based on clinical data. We use loads of parameters, the physiology of the patient. Those are MES scores and Ganga scores, those things to help you decide what to do with the limb itself. What we need is a better way of reporting what's happened.
Okay, final comment from Alan.
With the exception of contamination, you're describing vascularity. That's all you've really said. That's actually what you want to know, is vascularity of your soft tissues. To know, will you get that closed without the tension? As you put tension on it, try to close it, something in vascular. That's your concern, isn't it?
Okay.
predominantly, yeah.
So that's what plastic surgeons want to know. Whether you do transcutaneous oxygen, they're not great approach, but things like that, you actually could get, well, that's what you need is an objective measure. And I would tell you that. So without selling my story, you've got, you know, there are other ways of doing that. I think that will give you the answer you want.
Fantastic, Alex, great job, and it's great to see a pitch. It's not all about trials, even I've always said that. There are other ways of doing things. And actually, sometimes using the classifications for screening for the future research is more important than actually going ahead and just doing another trial, as we found out to our cost in the past. So final brave knight to face the dragons is Xavier Griffin.
So I was thinking about what Becky and the other guy said about there being the most important study. And this is obviously the most important study because in the textbooks this is called the unsolved fracture. So all of you are in equipoise right at the word go. So you all agree with me before I even start, which is good news. So undisplaced hips, what I'm really talking about here is undisplaced intercapsular fractures. So where are we at the moment? So many of you in the room have been involved in writing the NICE guidance, and this is what we currently have around intercapsular fractures. It is sort of summarised, but you know, we do arthroplasty of one or other option for our displaced hips. There is no description of what a displaced hip is, but the assumption is that we all recognise what a displaced hip is. And in the trauma meeting, you see a displaced intercapsular fracture, and they're getting a hip of one type or another. And there's nothing else written in the NICE guidance about intercapsular fractures, particularly about undisplaced intercapsular fractures. But there is a scoping document out for an update, which some people are involved with, and they're looking at the clinical effectiveness of three different treatments for this undisplaced intercapsular fracture. So NICE are going to come up with an answer. None of us know what the answer is, and I'm sure the people that are involved would be shot down if they were to tell us what they're doing. I'm pretty confident, having read the literature, I'm sure you all agree with me, that they're going to come up with something along the lines of, we don't know. Because the literature doesn't know. If you read the Cochrane Reviews, which will have the same evidence that NICE has, there is no answer to this particular problem. It is the unsolved fracture. So I think we all agree that we need to do a study. The question is, can we work out together a way of delivering that study that's going to be successful? Because we're going to need a lot of patients. Because it's not a relatively common, it's not a that common fracture amongst the fracture populations. So what is an undisplaced fracture? It's probably the thorniest issue. These are all intracapsular fractures. In the top right there, you've got a picture of an effusion. Your top right, picture of effusion, you've got MRI diagnosis with normal plane films, you've got a lap, you've got a varus impacted fracture, you've got a displaced fracture, and top left you've got the varus impacted fracture lateral, which looks pretty good on the lateral with no posterior tilt. These are all intracapsular fractures. And what we need to agree, and this is where I need some help, and I'm not quite yet at the ready to deliver the study. What we need to do is we need to agree how we're going to group these patients in a way that we understand and that we all agree on so that we can recruit all of our undisplaced fractures into a study. So, I think we can start here. We can say intracapsular fractures, we all agree what an intracapsular fracture is, and there's a spectrum. And that spectrum probably goes from your left-hand side, normal x-rays. So whatever x-rays you take of your department, they're normal. But the patient you think has got the fracture, and you do the MRI scan or the CT, cross-section imaging, and you diagnose a fracture that you can't see on the plain films. So that's one end. And at the other end is your displaced fractures. So 100% displaced, they're going to get a hemi, no discussion. That's NICE guidance. And what you're confronted with in the trauma meeting is deciding, am I going to treat these in one of three options? These are the only three things you can do with a patient, so you've got to choose one of these. Now, if we draw a line, and I don't know where that line goes, but apparently we're all happy with a line between displaced and undisplaced, and our displaced patients get an arthroplasty. So we all agree whether we can actually write down what that line should be. We all agree there is a line there, and we know what that line is in our minds. And that leaves the other side of the line as being anything other than a displaced fracture, which is undisplaced, therefore. And they should get fixation or arthroplasty, probably. there's some disagreement about that. So just looking at that then, if we're talking about undisplaced fractures, we've got the group that we're going to definitely do an arthroplasty for because they're displaced, so let's just forget those. And then at the other end of the spectrum, and I can't draw the line, and this line's even fuzzier, but I can't draw it, there's a group that I'm not interested in because probably we don't want to do an arthroplasty, although that might be contentious. There's a group at the other end who are very difficult to diagnose as a fracture that may not be appropriate for a fixed versus arthroplasty study, which leaves us with the middle ground. And I summarised it as heavy, but fixed versus arthroplasty. So could we as a group decide where those boundaries lie in some language that everyone understands and that everyone's happy to round about to, that means something in clinical practice that you can actually deliver on the ground when you're sat in the trauma meeting. So, step one. Can we agree that basically we're talking about the NHS deemed population? Over 60 years of age with an intercapsular fracture. Anyone think that's unreasonable? Bob, you thought it was unreasonable last night.
Depends what you're going to say next. Quick, quick,
so we'll start there. So over 60 years of age with intercapsular fracture, then we'll, the areas of contention we'll throw our cube around for. You can see the fracture on an x-ray. And I don't care what x-rays you use, because different people do different things, and we found that out yesterday in one of the breakout sessions. But you can diagnose it on an x-ray, not cross-sectional imaging. And it's not a displaced fracture. And I don't care what your definition of a displaced fracture is, but if it's a displaced fracture and you're going to do a hemi, then it's a displaced fracture. And it falls into the other side of the nice guidance. And then there's these two controversial things, which I've got in brackets here. So some people think that we could define a displaced fracture as one which can be fixed in situ. And some people think that they might be over 60, but wouldn't benefit from an arthroplasty if they had an undisplaced fracture. And so perhaps we can have a form of words that says, there's a group of patients who are 82 years old on average, typically a woman, who falls over and gets an undisplaced fracture. And they're the fixed versus hemi group you're interested in. And then there's the 61-year-old man that was out doing an Ironman on a bicycle and sustained an undisplaced fracture. Maybe that's a different patient and we don't want to put them in the trial. But there's probably something in the language around there where we can, without doing stuff that we're never going to do in clinical practice, we can describe. So that's where we need the help. So we value dragons and more particularly the guys in the audience, guys and girls in the audience.
I'm not sure that was a pitch, that was a manifesto, I think, from the Knights of Prochnow, but we'll hand it over to Dragon Thompson for a review.
Thanks. It's interesting that the last thing you were talking about, I thought, was a key, the mixture of patients. And it's sort of also similar to Rebecca's earlier presentation, that you could, being a non-clinician, but I could envisage that the Ironman people may respond quite differently to any treatment given to 81 with osteoporosis. So, and I don't know what the solution is to that problem, but I think to the problem, one solution could be is that you run two trials in parallel where you have your elderly osteoporotic people in one trial and the other trial is powered to look at just the Ironman people, and then you would, you would just do them separately. It wouldn't be an interaction, so you would just do them simultaneously to get the benefits from running the logistics of running the trials together. But you wouldn't actually; they'd be two separate trials. But I'm not sure.
I think that would work for me. But there's people. I asked everyone here. So would you be happy in this 61-year-old Ironman triathlete that's just done 100 miles in a bike, would you be happy putting in a hip?
Yeah. Well, this
everyone's happy.
This is the absolute crux of this. This is about patient selection, because the trial doesn't work if we can't define a patient group. So do you guys want to hang on for a second? I'll just throw this to Tim and to Bob.
So the answer for that is calling a fragility fracture. So if someone falls from a standing height or a low energy injury, which is a definition of a fragility fracture, this is the population you're looking for. The young, elderly Iron Man is rare, sense teeth, and wouldn't be appropriate. Surely that's it.
Yeah.
Okay. No,
that's
it. Do you want to?
I like that. Because I think the difference between this and aim is that the contentious part of AIM was offering somebody a non-operative management, which is easier to sell than it is saying we're going to do a bigger operation than we would have done before. So I think that makes it a little different in getting the consent. So you can either put an age to it, you can put an artificial age to it, and then you'd argue about that was, or you need some other useful definition that people can then silo the patients, and I think fragility fracture is fine, because that's what you're concerned about. It's the frailer patient. I think that would be an easy from the words.
Right, this is right. We've got to nearly the end of the Orthopaedic Trauma Society meeting 2017, and we've had two consecutive speakers, surgeons who've agreed. So we need something contrary to that. Go on, sir.
Xavier, it's a great topic to have a trial on. The question I've got is about displacement. Some units would not get a lateral x-ray and just rely on displacement of the AP. And I think there's a paper from Edinburgh which say if you're going to fix the undisplaced fractures, then you need to look at the lateral x-ray. And if it is off on the lateral x-ray, then they would be better off with an arthroplasty. So how are you going to solve that issue?
So I totally agree. That's why I said if you can see it on an x-ray and rather than finding it. Now, you could argue that we don't need the x-ray card. We could just say a fragility fracture in the over 60s, because that's the NHFG group, so fragility fracture effectively, and it's not displaced, i.e. you're not doing a definite hemi, you're not in that nice groove, and then just leave it at that.
John?
Yeah, I think this is a good trial, and we don't know the answer to this particular question. In relation to putting patients into it, I think you can probably just have it as you've indicated, that you would put in patients with a fragility fracture that's considered to be undisplaced. Because actually, although some fractures there's a bit of debate about, and we find ourselves arguing in trauma meetings, the majority of patients with these, you know, are valgus impacted fractures, right? And we get about 50 a year, and the majority, we are in agreement that it is a valgus impacted undisplaced fracture, and that would be the group that would be suitable for inclusion in the trial. I wouldn't favour running two trials. I think that's too complicated, because the numbers of these patients are not big. So we have 1,000 hip fractures a year, and we've only got 50 of these. So there's not a large number of them. I certainly wouldn't favour any trial that was going to include a third limb of non-operative, because they fall off some of these things. So a non-operative treatment is bad. So a two-limb trial would be good. But I think it would need to be quite big, because if you take our unit, we've got 50 a year, that, and even if you randomise them all, which you wouldn't do, obviously, you still only have 25 in each limb. And so it would need to be quite a large multi-centre trial, so probably it's going to...
Feasibility again, you think, John? Is that where you're going in?
I think so, yes, definitely. Yep.
Okay. Good. Nigel, do you want to take a view? Is there something about the MR diagnosed fracture here?
No.
Thank you.
So I think this absolutely has to be done, but I disagree with Tim, because the 60-year-old Iron Man, that is almost the most difficult person to make the decision on, and we don't know the answers to that. And I also disagree with John. There are people around the country who will treat these non-operatively, and we don't know how many of them fall off.
I agree with that.
So I think you have to have all comers over the age of 60. I think you have to include a total hip group as well as the hemiarthroplasty group. It's just arthroplasty.
Yeah, and then you can bring it. Sorry, I summarised this hemi to fit right on the slide. So it's
and as John has quite rightly pointed out, these are going to be small numbers. Why can't we do a white type study and embed this in the NJR?
Right, final word from Alan. Sorry, guys, I know there's more comments on this. This is always going to be a contentious one from
This has got pragmatic studies written all over it. You know, which are always a bit concerned about pragmatic studies. But, you know, the biggest issue you've got here is you actually don't know if you can judge that patient group. And although it's pretty expensive, you'd really want to know is, can I identify these fractures which I'm happy to fix inside you? That's what you then need to know, is how good is your estimation on your ability to judge that x-ray, short of that, you've actually got to know, am I good at doing this? On the whole, can we judge these? I'm afraid to say, you have to go and image these. You have to say, this is a fracture I want to do, and I will image it to whatever degree I need to know to make sure that from evermore, my X-ray judgment of these is correct or good enough to then take this on to another study. After that, I think the study needs to be done.
Fantastic. Right, I'm going to have to bring this to a close. So, just finally, we had a bit of a show of hands for Becky's suggestion. Is there anyone who wouldn't be in favour of supporting, hands up if you'd support all four of these projects going forward in your units and be an advocate for these questions within your units? Okay, guys, I think you've got what you came for. You've got a consensus from the Orthopaedic Trauma Society. So, thanks to Becky, Will, Alex and Xavier for presenting. And thanks to John and Anne particularly for representing the OTS here, but especially for David who's come all the way down from York especially to support orthopaedic trauma as a group. So thank you very much, David.